Applied Energistics is a high-tech mod for Minecraft. It brings in advanced tools for managing and storing items more efficiently. You can automate complex crafting tasks, set up smart storage networks, and make your in-game life much more organized and convenient. In this video, we'll delve into Subnetworks, P2P Tunnels, and Autocrafting. Subnetworks. In essence, a subnetwork is a dedicated, smaller network with certain access and interaction capabilities with the main network, and vice versa. It's established to serve a specific purpose. Why use subnetworks? Well, they serve as a strategic solution to various challenges. Firstly, they allow you to reduce the channels used in the main network, so you don't have to run dense cables everywhere, which are expensive. Secondly, they are the go-to solution when you need a level of separation from the main network for specialized tasks. As a result, subnetworks minimize the complexity of the main network and enhance overall efficiency. Constructing a subnetwork is a straightforward process. It can be either an ad hoc network, without a controller, or a standard network if more channels are required. In the previous episode, we learned that a storage bus is a device that reads an external inventory and incorporates it into the network inventory, while an interface is a container that can import or export items to and from the network. However, the interface serves another crucial function. It represents the entire network inventory. Therefore, if a storage bus from the subnetwork is attached to the main network interface, the subnetwork gains full access to the main network inventory. Subnetworks are capable of accepting energy either through its own energy acceptor or via a quartz fiber connected to a network with power, typically the main network. In this subnetwork, it is focused on smelting raw iron into iron ingots. It can take coals and raw iron from the main network, do the smelting, and then insert the ingots back into the main network. If you want to control what your subnetwork can see and use from the main network, you can adjust the settings of the storage bus. For instance, if you set the filter to coal, the subnetwork will only recognize coal, no matter what else is in the main network. By default, the filter works for both adding and taking items. If you only want the filter to apply when adding items, you can set it that way. So, from the subnetwork, you can see and take out all items, but you can only add coal into the main network. There are also options to completely block adding or taking items in this subnetwork. Subnetworks can be nested inside each other, which is pretty powerful. Also, not all subnetworks have to interact with the inventory of the main network. They can serve other purposes. For instance, some may be designed to hold P2P tunnels, which we'll get into in the next part. P2P tunnels. P2P, point-to-point, tunnels are like portals that connects two or more points. They have different variants that can transfer channels, item, fluid, redstone, light, energy. Each set of P2P tunnels must have an input tunnel, and one or more output tunnels. Tunnels can be linked by a linking card. Shift right-click on the input tunnel to copy its ID, then right-click on the output tunnels to link it with the input. As you can see, a dense cable with 32 channels go into the input tunnel. At the output tunnels, that same 32 channels come out. If there are more than one outputs, the channel will be splitted among the outputs, so the total channel that come out of all output tunnels is still 32. Why use P2P tunnels? For the ME variant, it helps to compress the channels. Let's say I have 32 dense cables going into the P2P inputs, and then transfer those channels to P2P outputs somewhere far away. This makes it possible to transfer up to 1024 channels in a single dense cable. As for other variants, they utilize the already existing ME cable lines for the transport of conventional items, fluids, energy, etc., through the system, without directly interacting with the contents of the ME system. All P2P types can be nested within other ME P2P. However, there is an exception for the ME variant. A channel that is already carrying a MIP P2P cannot pass through another MIP P2P. Autocrafting. Autocrafting is one of the most powerful features from AE2. Please note that this is a complex topic. You can see the wiki page if needed, link in the description. With autocrafting, you can request a certain amount of items, then the network will take all the ingredients, process them into the result, even if it needs to go through many different recipes. You can also keep a certain amount of items in stock by requesting autocraft automatically. To start autocrafting, first, you need to teach the system the recipe of the items you want to craft, in the pattern terminal. There are many recipe types, but they are split into two categories, crafting and processing. Crafting consists of types such as crafting, smithing, and stonecutting recipes. These recipes are instant and do not require any fuel or energy to craft. Processing, on the other hand, includes types such as smelting and machine recipes from mods. The way it works is that you specify ingredients and the expected result. The network doesn't care what to do with the ingredients, as long as it receives the result afterward. To encode a recipe, you have to put a blank pattern into the slot, then click the button, the encoded pattern will come out at the other slot. Next, you need to put these patterns into the pattern provider. This block acts as an interface for inputting and outputting items, and also can hold encoded patterns. You can pump the items in and out via item pipes from other mods, or use the directional versions of the pattern provider. These will push the items directly into adjacent blocks for the crafting process. For crafting recipes, we need to use the molecular assembler. By itself, the molecular assembler acts as an automatic crafting table. You can put encoded patterns into it, and it will craft the items as long as there are enough ingredients in its inventory. Do note that the molecular assembler inventory won't fill itself with ingredients when an autocraft request is made, you need to insert them somehow. But when a pattern provider is placed next to a molecular assembler, you can put the recipes inside the pattern provider instead, and when a crafting request is made, it will push the exact amount of needed ingredients into the molecular assembler. By this way, you can share a molecular assembler with multiple pattern providers, and vice versa. For processing various types of recipes, all you need to do is attach a pattern provider to a machine. Additionally, you need a method to return the resulting item back to the system. Extra filtering can be accomplished by using a subnet or item pipes. The last thing you need is a crafting CPU, which holds an autocraft request. If you want to make 5 different requests at a time, for example, then you will need 5 separated crafting CPUs in the network. The crafting CPU is built for many blocks. The mandatories are crafting storage. They come in different sizes. If your recipe is huge with thousands of ingredients, you might need to use a bigger size. By default, the CPU will do each task in a request one by one. But with the crafting co-processing unit, it will work on more tasks at the same time if possible. The crafting monitor will show the crafting request progress. The crafting unit is a filler block to help form the crafting CPU. All blocks must be placed in a rectangular box to form a crafting CPU. In addition to manually requesting items, you can also use a crafting card to automate the process. The crafting card is an upgrade for Mi Export Bus or Mi Interface. When installed, it allows the network to automatically craft items to keep a certain amount in stock. For the Export Bus, there are two modes. First, export the items in the network and then craft them, or always craft the items, regardless of whether there are still items of that type in the network. You can use the level emitter and redstone card to control when the export bus should craft. This is all the content of this episode. If you want to see more, please comment down below. Thanks for watching, and have a good day.